so excited. National Public Radio affiliate, Jazz 91.9, WCLK, Atlanta's Jazz Station. A broadcast service of Clark Atlanta University.
You gotta do better than that. I can't hear you.
I'm Jones, and you're listening to Midday Jazz with Riva
Blue.
Thank
you so much.
Jazz 91.9, WCLK, Atlanta's Jazz Station.
So we want to stay on target. So please welcome to the stage, to get our program started, Assistant Provost and Executive Director for the Center for Academic and Student Success, Dr. Cynthia Clem. Let's give Dr. Clem a round of applause. Thank you, Dr. Thank you.
Good morning, Clark Atlanta. Welcome to our first year seminar lecture with our very special guests. You are all welcome, and we are very happy that you all have taken the time to join us for what we know will be a thoughtful conversation today with the son of our beloved Clark Atlanta University. To the first year seminar faculty, thank you for accepting the challenge to mentor, nurture, and guide our first year scholars. To the staff, academic leadership, to our deans, to our chairs, to the executive cabinet and administrators joining us today. We are grateful for your service and commitment to all of our scholars. To the 1,123 members of the Clark Atlanta University class of 2025, including 991 freshmen and 132 advanced freshmen. Today, the class of 2025 is represented by this socially distanced gathering. We are indeed grateful that you are a member of our family. Today, we would also like to salute Mr. and Ms. Freshman class. Would you all please stand? We also salute members of Freshman Council. Would you all give us a wave? Who are the Freshman Council is assisting to host us on this morning, and we are grateful for your leadership as you are hosting us on today. To our beloved and distinguished president, Dr. George T. French, Jr., we are grateful for your leadership, we're grateful for your service, and we are grateful for your commitment and your vision for dear old Clark Atlanta University. To the friends and family who have accompanied our lecturer on today, and who have accompanied our lecturer and author on today, welcome, and welcome back to some of you. We appreciate your presence. To Mrs. Mary Ware, we count it an honor and a blessing to occupy this hallowed space with you on this morning. Welcome back home. There will be a formal introduction of our lecturer for the hour, so I will save that. At this time, please receive our Provost and Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs, Dr. Wesson.
Gentlemen, I should have waited for her to come down. I apologize. I want my freshmen to know that that's the proper way to handle this. Okay. The first year seminar is a centerpiece of the core curriculum at Clark Atlanta University. The course was designed to provide the first year and transfer students with an introduction to the Clark Atlanta community and to strategies for successful transition and participation within this community. Through the course, the values and expectations of the university are defined, and regulations and requirements are transmitted. Institutional resources and support services are identified, and the issues critical topics are introduced. All first year students this year will read Portrait of an American Businessman, One Generation from Cotton Field to Boardroom. We are proud to say that that book is is authored by our university trustee and chair emeritus, Mr. Carl Ware. The Clark Atlanta University community is excited about this opportunity to engage with our esteemed lecturer. So without any further ado, I'll introduce our esteemed president, the fifth president of Clark Atlanta University, Dr. George T. French, Jr.
Dean Udoka, did the provost forget my name? Good morning, Clark Atlanta University. Students, faculty, staff, alumni, and friends who joined us today for this very special first year seminar, Lyceum series. We welcome you to this Lyceum series. To my wife, who is in absentia, she is on her way. My daughter is a student at Woodward, and they began class today late because of the baseball celebration. So she's on her way, and she gives her regrets, but she's looking forward to seeing Mr. and Mrs. Ware. We're delightful to see, again, alumna, Miss Mary Ware, Karen Ware, alumni, Trustee Emeritus, Dr. Eldridge McMillan, and Dr. Frank Johnson, who I might note parenthetically that Dr. Johnson is in the process of writing a book about Dr. Eldridge McMillan. Thanks, Dr. Clem, for such a hearty welcome, for all that you put in. Thank you, Dr. Kimbrough, for your leadership also in putting this program together. This is my first year seminar at this great institution, and I'm honored to present our guest lecturer for the morning, who is truly an American treasure and success story. He has asked that I would be brief, that we might have more time for the actual lecture and for you to engage in questions and answers. You can, and as well as the book signing, you can read his full bio, which is printed in your program today. However, I would like to highlight a few milestones, just a few. He was born to humble Georgia sharecroppers in Newnham, Georgia. He faced hardships while growing up black in a Jim Crow South. His father made history as the first black man to vote in the Georgia's fifth congressional district election since Reconstruction. He worked his way through Clark College, which is where he met the love of his life, Mary Ware. And since that time, he has been married to Mary Ware. And if I could epitomize what that relation looks like when people talk about it around the world and throughout the country, it's like looking at the beautiful picture that's hanging on the wall. You appreciate the picture and the accomplishments, but that picture could not be on that wall without that nail right there, which is Mary Ware. Thank you, Miss Ware. In 1979, well, let me say he worked his way through Clark College while taking part in the Atlanta student movement inspired by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. He rose to become one of the most influential business leaders and philanthropists of his generation. He was elected to the Atlanta City Council in 1973 and later served as Atlanta City Council's first black president. In 1979, he was named vice president of special markets for Coca-Cola USA. As the highest ranking African-American executive at the Coca-Cola Company, he became the architect. This is huge. He became the architect of Coca-Cola's South Africa divestment, and the first African-American businessman to meet with Nelson Mandela after his release from prison in 1990. And now, he shares his incredible story, inspiring story, And he shares it with us as students, faculty, and staff so that we might appreciate his engagement and these students understand lessons from his book about how to be successful. I'm going to close with this because it's vitally important. I loved going through the library the other day and seeing the students read this book. And I stopped and engaged them to have conversations. And one of the most important things about this book is I was honored to give the introduction to Mr. Ware today. But when you look at the introduction that was given to this book, the foreword was given by Archbishop Desmond Tutu. Archbishop Tutu was the Bishop of Johannesburg and later the Archbishop of Cape Town. In this book, this is what Archbishop Desmond Tutu says that Nelson Mandela wrote. He says that Nelson Mandela wrote to Carl Ware and said, when the history of our struggle is properly reviewed in the near future, only then will the world be privy to fully understand your catalytic role in that struggle. We know of countless contributions made to innumerable individuals and organizations in our country through your direct intervention. This you did not only in your capacity as one of the decision makers within Coca-Cola, but also in your own right as a conscientious human being of African descent. He says, I was born at home in a tiny shack next to a railroad track in Coweta County, Georgia. My parents were sharecroppers who worked other people's land, laboring alongside their 12 children. From such humble beginnings, I rose to become the highest ranking African-American executive at the Coca-Cola Company, the most recognizable brand in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, on your feet, please, to recognize and receive our speaker, Mr. Carl Ware.
Thank you very much, Dr. French. Now that you've given my speech, I will just start entertaining questions. Thank you so much for that very generous introduction. Mighty kind of you. You know, it's easy to take things for granted, and I want you to know that I do not take lightly. In fact, this is probably the most exciting event experience that I have ever enjoyed in the many years that I've been associated with Clark Atlanta University. Just to speak to you guys this morning in this kind of a setting about some things that I did, not alone, but with the help of many, many others, is an honor. I'm honored, I'm excited, I mean, I am tremendously pleased to be here this morning. So thank you very much. Dr. Wesson, to Dr. Clem, faculty, and to my good friend, and I admire him so much for what he has done for our great institution, Dr. French, you are a great leader, and we appreciate you. Thank you so much. So thank you for choosing my book as the book that you will read over and over again, I hope, to enjoy sometimes, and then pass that copy on to someone else. Thank you very much. I hope this will be the first in a series of these kind of meetings, I'll do my very best because in a real sense, this is a partnership. We're making history here today. This is the partnership. I'll do my very best to hold up my end of the bargain by imparting some thoughts and some stories that will hopefully help you as you navigate the next 4 years here at Clark Atlanta University and in your life and beyond. But I have a charge for you. And your part of the deal might be easier or it may be more difficult depending upon how you look at it. I want you to simply cut off your devices. Shut down your social media network platforms, Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, Snapchat, YouTube. Did I name them all? Do we have a deal?
Yes, sir.
All right, then. Oh, the most important, do we have a deal, folks?
Yes.
All right. Then what I'm going to do is then I'll think about not giving you the mandatory assignment that I was going to give you at the end of this session. So we'll see what happens. So let's get started. I want to talk about my book as a learning tool. And the first thing you need to know is that this is a book about struggle. It's a book about leadership. Leadership of people who have populated my life, who exemplify true leadership that is great leadership. And in that regard, there are six things that I want to cover this morning. That is what motivated me to write the book in the first place and how it got written. I know there may be some aspiring authors out there, so I want to tell you that story. Then I want to tell you how my upbringing instilled the values that propelled my success in life. Thirdly, what inspired me to become a businessman? I have a short story I want to tell you about that. Fourthly, the big events of my life that brought about significant change, and that's five events, and the five people who influenced that process and impacted my success. Finally, I want to end with what's expected of you as future leaders. Well, about writing a book, shortly before I retired from Coca-Cola, I started the process in, back in 2003 of writing this my memoirs, and only to realize that my life and my story was had not ended. In many ways, it was just beginning. So I put it away for a few years, and I let it steep for a few years, and then in 2016, it became my passion to finish the book. I thought about the book, and as I reflected on the city of Atlanta, and which has been long recognized as a city nationally and internationally in culture, business, politics, civil rights, and I realized that I had been a part of the policies, the people, and everything around some of the great events that made Atlanta what it is today. And then I reflected on my role on the world stage, meeting and working alongside some of the world's greatest and most renowned leaders who had brought about significant change in the world. And then some of my friends, very close friends, reminded me, said, Carl, you know, you really do need to finish this thing. You need to write it because it could be an inspiration to many black and current and future leaders, folks just like you, an inspiration to you. So how the book got written. The first thing that I learned at Coca-Cola as I worked through my career there and at City Hall for that matter is that I want to surround myself with people who can help me do things, to accomplish things. I want people who are smarter than me around me. I want people who know how to write a book. I mean, heck, I could write a memo. I could, you know, write an article every now and then, but when I started writing this book, that was the most difficult thing that I'd ever tried in my life. And I needed people around me. So I hooked up with Sibley Fleming, who helped me assemble a team of people, a team of research and social media specialists, people like Paulette Jones here, who is my right hand today still. She did the research and social media platforms for the book, a book designer, a lawyer, a libel reader. I did not know that you had to hire and pay $30,000 to get somebody to read your book so that you stay out of trouble. Well, I did. So then a photographer, an indexer, and then I consulted with a canon lawyer in South Africa by the name of Matt Esau, who was a canon lawyer for the Anglican Church. And Matt turned me on to a political consultant, and there were others who helped me write the book. Short of a long story, Dr. Magdalene, I'm stealing the title of your book now. During the process of writing the book, we took several research trips, and the last culminating in a trip in 2018 that I visited with Archbishop Desmond Tutu and his lovely wife, Leah Tutu, my close friends. He indeed committed at that visit to doing the foreword to my book. Hot dog, I'm on the way now. Well, I tell you, that was a great, great, and incredibly important visit. But let me tell you about an incredible interview that I had. We did about 40 interviews. We did, you know, interviews with the likes of Ambassador Young and four of my siblings and many others. But this particular one was a lady by the name of Miss.
Let me fix my hair.
Strange in Hogansville, Georgia. She was a direct descendant of white Wares of Heard and Coweta County, who had enslaved my ancestors from Africa. And at the end of that interview we had with her, she handed me a document. The document entitled The Wares of Heard County, a factual account of when my ancestors were brought to their plantation in 1827. So, as time rocked on, we went on and did what we needed to do, many interviews and many more, transcribing many, but at the end, the internet became my closest ally. I tell you, I fought the internet like you wouldn't believe before then, but I, you know, started looking at it, and you know, I could do fact check, I could do Grammarly, I could do all kinds of things with that thing and find out dates and times that I thought I knew that I simply did not know. The internet became my closest ally. So then partnering with Mercer University, let me tell you this, for those of you aspiring writers, find a publisher who will give you the maximum freedom and control over your product, over what you're trying to communicate to the audiences. That's very important. That's what Mercer University Press did for me, and I'm very grateful that we had a great time. Let me just go on now and tell you about things that happened in my growing up, my upbringing, that instilled the values that propelled my success. As Dr. French said, I was born near a railroad track in rural Coweta County in a little mill town called Arnco, Georgia, in rural Coweta County. I had 11 siblings, 5 brothers and 6 sisters. My mother worked in the mill houses of the white mill workers. They weren't much better off than we were, but that's the way things went in those days. My father swept the floors of the mill, the cotton mill. And getting food on the table was difficult because we didn't live on a farm. We didn't grow our own food. And so many days we made it by the grace of God with that biscuit, with that syrup, and with that white rice. I tell you, food came from the farm, from the land. So my father also suffered with asthma. And after his reckoning with God, and much prayer at his favorite prayer rock in the book, the prayer rock, Mama and Daddy moved our family to a plantation where we became sharecroppers. And I can tell you that raising a family in the Jim Crow South was extremely difficult for black folks in the 40s and 50s, and made more difficult by segregation, intimidation, and violence. I can just tell you one more story on that issue. I remember at 6 years old, we would go to school and register around the day after Labor Day, September, and we wouldn't get back to school till about the 1st of October because we had to bring in the harvest from the field, picking the cotton and corn and all that stuff. But this one day, as we were walking to school, the school bus that we couldn't ride at the time came driving by us, and the white kids started throwing rocks at us, and we had to dodge and go into the bushes and jump into the ditches. I remember getting so angry that I wanted to pick up a rock and throw it at that bus. But had I done that, I wouldn't be standing here today making these remarks. I didn't throw that rock because I was fortunate to have three people in my life, my mother and my father, who taught us that there were smarter ways to handle bigotry and hate. My parents instilled in me the courage to avoid trouble and adversity. And I had a first grade teacher named Miss Sadie Allen. She didn't tolerate no foolishness. And man, I tell you, she was strict. And yet I recall the story when the Ku Klux Klan tried to invade our home. And my father and my older brothers courageously stood them down. My father with his courageous words and my older brothers with their arsenals of shotguns and rifles stood them down and ran them away from our doorstep that night, that Friday night. I learned then the value of standing up against my adversaries. Another important lesson I learned early in life was what it means to control my own destiny. I was just 4 years old when my daddy struck that sharecropping agreement with the white plantation owner. And the deal was that the entire Ware family, just an army of laborers, would work as sharecroppers and live in a little hut that, well, gosh, I mean, I tell you, we slept on top of each other. But we would live there rent-free in exchange for our labor in the cotton field. But my father was smart. He struck a deal, a 50-50 deal with this plantation owner. Now, the typical deal was that a deal would be one-third would go of the crops raised would go to the sharecropping family, two-thirds to the white plantation owner. My daddy struck a deal for 50-50, and boy, was he a deal maker. Sharecropping was, let me tell you, young folk, you know, people used to ask me when I was working abroad, they used to see me working 12, 15 hours a day, 7 days a week, and they asked me, why are you working? This ain't work. I tap dance through this job every day. You ain't seen no hard work. Sharecropping was tough, toiling work, just one step away from slavery, one step out of slavery. So it was against this bleak backdrop that my world would begin, and we'd start thinking about controlling our own destiny. Let me be clear. The vision that my mother and father had for owning that first 50 acres of land was counterintuitive to the times when other black families in our neighborhood and in our community were fleeing the Jim Crow South for what Isabel Wilkerson calls the Great Migration, the warmth of another sun, of other suns. Finally, in 1956, we had enough money to buy that 50 acres of land. And by the way, we still live on it. That's where I live. I drive up and down the road every day between Atlanta and Noonan, Coweta County, on the same farm that we sharecropped. And so my mama always said, though, after we were able to buy that land and start raising our own food, we built our own home with our own hands, she always said that everybody was welcome to our table and that nobody should be so poor that they didn't have something to share with someone in greater need. That lesson is what drove Mary and me to contribute to build the Carl and Mary Ware Academic Center. Hard work, discipline, education, 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 preparation, 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 humility, faith in God and faith in oneself. Values that I needed to overcome the many obstacles, seemingly impossible odds, to seize opportunity and make a difference. This is a good segue into, and I'll briefly talk about one day my vision of becoming a businessman was prompted by my Uncle Alfonso while we were out stripping sugarcane and getting it ready to take to the syrup mill so that my father could grind it and cook it and make the best sorghum syrup in the county. He said, "Sport, what do you want to be?" Everybody called me Sport then because I was always bouncing a ball off against something, you know, or a rock. We made our balls, by the way, by entwining a lot of cloth around a rock, and that became our baseball. We wrapped it so tight and put glue or something on it, that was our baseball. So anyway, I said, he says, "Sport, what do you want to be?" I said, "I want to be a businessman." "What do you know about being a businessman? You look like a preacher or a teacher to me." That was a great compliment back in those days, but I said, "No, Uncle Alfonso, I was 12 years old. I want to be a businessman." He said, "Well, that's what you want to be, son. That's what you ought to be." But then something else happened. I subscribed to the Atlanta Journal, the Atlanta Constitution newspaper, which is delivered to our home every Sunday. I read that newspaper from front to cover, especially the business section. And then I found a copy of an old Atlanta Daily World, black-owned Daily World newspaper, and in it, I saw black folks. Man, I saw black folks owning insurance companies, banks, savings and loans associations in Atlanta, restaurants. I even saw where a gentleman by the name of J.B. Blayton owned a business training school out on which is now Martin Luther King Jr. Drive, used to be near Adamsville. This business training school was a forerunner to what we call today our technical colleges or two-year colleges. What they did was train you how to do the basic fundamental business work in an office, in a doctor's office or a lawyer's office or wherever. But it also was a feeder school to Clark, Morris Brown, Spelman and Morehouse's bachelor's degree. It was owned by a black man. This was 60 years ago. Wow. So it was out of that kind of reading and background that I got my spark of curiosity about being a businessman. Now let me tell you a brief story of how that played out. When I took over the business in as president of Coca-Cola Africa, I took over a business system that was the epitome of the colonial, the old European colonial system in Africa. The headquarters was in London. We had operating offices in Morocco, Casablanca. We had Lagos, Nigeria. We had Nairobi, Kenya. We had Cote d'Ivoire, Abidjan, and we had one in Harare, Zimbabwe, and then finally one in South Africa. Of all of the profit and loss managers on my team at the time, all of them were European or white male Americans. And I said at the first management meeting, I said, folks, do you believe in Africa? They were, yes, sir, we believe in Africa. I said, well, if you do, then you will find Africans who will do your job in 5 to 10 years. And so from that day forward, we scoured the universities all over America, all over Europe, all over Africa, and we hired seasoned African executives who became the general managers and who ran in time the Coca-Cola business on the continent of Africa. That was my calling, and that's what we did. I won't dwell a lot more on the 5 events because I do want to save enough time for Q&A. But there were 5 people who impacted my success that I want to highlight. There were more, but I want to highlight these 5. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Maynard Holbrook Jackson, Archbishop Desmond Tutu, Roberto C. Gusueta, and Nelson Mandela. Quickly, Dr. King. I was fortunate to be one of those students in the generation that was here on campus during the Civil Rights Movement, the height of the Civil Rights era. And it was very frequent that we would sit at rallies where Dr. King spoke and other civil rights leaders spoke on this campus. And one of the things that Dr. King taught us was that as important as your classroom work is, it is equally important for you to fight for your freedom and your justice. And so it was okay for us to go out and march and walk that picket line from Fair and Brawley down across the Spring Street Viaduct to integrate Greater Hospital and to integrate Woolworth stores down there. That was very important. He influenced me, and when he was assassinated, I dedicated my thoughts and life to running for public office so I could do one thing. That was to continue his vision and his dream of using political power to gain economic power for African Americans. That's what Dr. King, that's how he inspired me. Maynard Holbrook Jackson, one of my favorite people in the whole world. Morehouse graduate, great friend. We worked alongside each other together to create what is called the 25% solution to black economic empowerment. At the Atlanta airport, there were no black contractors. There were hardly any black-owned concessions at the Atlanta airport at the time. And when we introduced an ordinance to create mandatory 25% minority participation in that process, the Atlanta business community, Wall Street, they said, you're going to tarnish the stellar reputation of Atlanta's financial standing. The project is not going to turn in time. Let me tell you, they got it all wrong for the wrong reasons. We got it all right for the right reasons. And that ended up with at least 25% of all of the concessions and contracts at Atlanta Hartsfield International Airport being owned and operated by African American women and other minorities. Maynard had a tremendous influence on my success. And so, as did Roberto Gusueta. Roberto entrusted me with the power and the resources to change the Coca-Cola company from a company where there was very little diversity. He entrusted in me the power to change the board of directors to a diverse board, senior management, middle management, supplier development, and we created, under that program, the first African-American-owned Coca-Cola bottling franchise in the history of America. It became the fourth largest by capitalization black-owned business in America, the Philadelphia Coca-Cola Bottling Company. We duplicated that same business model in South Africa during post-apartheid South Africa in creating the Coca-Cola Bottling Company of Mpumalanga. That was in, and that's owned by one of my favorite South African families, the Kanini family. Archbishop Desmond Tutu inspired me to become the architect of the company's disinvestment. And what he did, let me tell you how he did that. He trusted me. He took me on to London to meet with the exile members of the ANC, Thabo Mbeki, who became the second president of South Africa under the democratic elected system. And then my friend Nelson Mandela. I can tell you I've never met anybody like him before nor since. When I walked into his office 30 days after he had been released from prison, after 27 years in prison, he embraced me as though he had known me all of his life. He had a regal bearing with a very down-to-earth presence. And ever since that day, any time that I flew into South Africa and I didn't come see him, he would put out a posse for me to come see him. And so he inspired me to build the reentry strategy to South Africa. Those are the five events. Now, finally, what's expected of you as future leaders? Because this is so important as you plot your future and here at CAU and beyond, it's very important for you. I want you to know that Clark Atlanta University has molded the minds of many leaders, great intellectuals, activists, political leaders, international diplomats, scientists, pioneers in business, theology, engineering, technology, economics, educators, musicians, sports, entertainment, and the list goes on. Clark Atlanta University has done that job and done it well. This is your heritage. That means you must strive to do something bold and impactful. I would argue that you have an even greater calling to ensure that George Floyd, Michael Brown, Tamir Rice, Trayvon Martin, Kendra James, Breonna Taylor, Rekia Boyd, Eric Garner, Ayanna Stanley Jones, Tanisha Anderson, Rashad Brooks, Jacob Blake, and Ahmaud Arbery's life mattered. That's what you are achieving, what you're achieving. At the end of the day, I don't like that term either, but I use it sometimes. At the end of the day, what it's all about is you becoming leaders and you becoming the carriers of the torch and really undergirding the fact that black lives do matter. These lives matter. So in everything you do, do the right thing. Do it right the first time. Trust in God. Believe in yourself. Always be prepared to perform at the very highest level. Be prepared. to perform at the very highest level. Remember that no matter the circumstances of your birth, no matter where you come from, you can achieve, you can succeed, you can make a difference in your time on this earth. As Mandela once said, after climbing a great hill, one only finds that there are many more hills to climb. Thank you.
Taking me back in history. I came to Atlanta in 1981, and those were the game changers on the scene, some of the individuals that he mentioned. And what I admired about Atlanta in 1981, Atlanta was a little sleepy town, barely 500,000 people, compared to the, 7 or 8 million now? And it was known as a, you know, family town and whatever. But what separated Atlanta from all the other southern cities, and even the northern cities, was that Atlanta, there was no need to pull Atlanta kicking and screaming through the civil rights struggle. And it was only because of brothers and sisters, and you got one right here in Carl Ware. Now, what made his book and the section of his book that I was drawn to, though Atlanta didn't have to be pulled kicking and screaming through civil rights, certainly Coca-Cola had to do it, and you did it. And you did it. Carl, Mr. Ware, CEO, you know, Trustee Emeritus, what stuck out in my mind, how in the world in the 1980s are you going to have Civil War generals' portraits, in your headquarters? Like, blacks don't drink Coke. And they didn't think anything was wrong with that. And you said in the book that you didn't know the reason why until the Journal Constitution took that picture of you and Nelson Mandela and you put your fist up. And the next day, one of your colleagues at Coca-Cola admonished you about that. There are so many bites on the apple in this book. I just want to thank you for taking the time. And this generation needs to know it. This generation needs to know it. This is walking history right here. Coweta County, what I would have done, the 2,200, you know, I remember the 2,200 blacks that sued Coca-Cola. All you had to do was take them and the higher ups of Coca-Cola to your plantation that you now own. That you now own. So you introduced the world to culture and diversity, you and Roosevelt Thomas, and let's dive in to this.
Thank you.
I don't need, I got all the questions that I want to ask. Go ahead, take this mic.
Sure, thanks.
And I'll take this, and they allow me to throw the first punch, and I'm going to throw it.
Sure.
All right, you got the absolute best and brightest freshman. What we got? 100 HBCUs, whatever? All right, you got some of the best and brightest first-year students in this room right now. Give me the one or two tools that have got to be in their toolbox if they want to walk in the same shoes that you've walked in.
Be a great listener. You know, listening is something that I really didn't quite understand.
Mm-hmm.
Well enough to appreciate how important it is to absorb what the person across from me or what I was listening to on radio or heard on TV or what my wife was saying or a friend was saying. Developing a keen listening ear. That's what Desmond Tutu had. He was a keen listener. Aside from being the consummate ecumenical leader, he could sit and listen to my pitch about what Coca-Cola was going to do to disinvest from South Africa, and he would listen with the ear of a religious icon, but he understood the secular aspect of what I was saying and what it meant to his country going forward. So I would say, number one, be a keen listener and understand what has been said and what you're listening to, and be able to be prepared to articulate and act on whatever it is that you decide to do. Education is the key. There is something very powerful about that talented 10 theory that people talk about. You are our talented 10% right here. And what you do will be emulated by everyone else. If you do the right thing and make the right choices, that will be emulated. If you do the wrong thing and not do what you're supposed to do while you're here and beyond, then that will be emulated too. So be a keen listener and be prepared to execute at your very highest level. Now, let me tell you something. I prayed my way through Clark College. I prayed my way through graduate school. I prayed my way through all of the international challenges that I had out there in the world. They ain't nothing like prayer. Nothing. Listen, I don't get me sorry. I'm not the most religious person in the world. Mary can tell you that. I don't go to church that much, but I even when we could go to church, but I am a firm believer in the power of God and God's the way He works. One of the things that I did all the time when I was traveling and I was up against many obstacles, whether it was here at home at Coca-Cola, down at the Coca-Cola Tower with the racism that was going on there, and we changed that culture, or whether I was out flying on an airplane from Zambia to Johannesburg, from Lusaka to Johannesburg, when the plane started to descend, we were taking off. And I remember that night, it was about 8 p.m. that evening, and suddenly the plane got to 5,000 feet and it dropped to 2,000 feet. And I didn't realize how serious it was until the flight attendant fell on the floor and started crying and screaming. And I, and what I did, I cited the 23rd Psalm.
Praise God.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restores my soul. And the part that I like about that Psalm, 23rd Psalm, so much, yea, though I walk through the valley in the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod, thy staff, they comfort me. He prepares the table before me, before my enemies. He anoints my head with oil. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall rest in the house of the Lord forever. Prayer is important. Whatever you do, don't ever forget the Lord. Don't ever forget to believe in yourself. Long answer, but from the heart.
You shared in your presentation, but I want to highlight it again. What is your most fondest memory as a freshman? I know that's how you met your lovely wife. Well, actually, you were a junior, and she was a freshman,
no,
correct?
I was a senior. I was a senior, and she was a sophomore.
Oh, okay.
Is that right?
Look at me. That's right. He needs coaching. Huh? He still needs coaching. But with your fondest memory?
Oh, gosh, my fondest memory as a freshman was, I think, let me tell you, working 8 hours a day and coming back to campus and getting into my studies wasn't a whole lot of time in between for me to have fun with that, like a lot of the other kids were doing. But I guess my fondest memory was watching the frat lines. I mean, the guys and the ladies online, the Kappas, the Omegas. I happened to join one of the fraternities shortly after that. But I guess it was that. And the other thing was, and that's makes me conjure up some more memories. Was just singing in the Philharmonic Society. I was a member of I got a $100 scholarship to sing in the Philharmonic, the Clark College Philharmonic Society. I sang alongside, and I was just a backup to Loretta Folks, and that name might ring a bell if it doesn't, look it up, Samuel Hagen. They were the two. They were the first two African Americans to perform with the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra. Mm-hmm. It was just that, and just homecoming, all of the fun that you guys are having now. We've been there, we've done that, and it was fun. College life was just a tremendous. It really taught me the life lessons, how you go from being a child to an adult and being a responsible adult, being responsible for yourself, not wasting your mom and daddy's money up here in hot Atlanta. So there was just so many things I could tell. I can remember Dr. Wiley Bolden, who was a dean of faculty, walking across the campus, and Mac and I share stories about Dr. Bolden, who lived to be 99 years old, was it, when he passed away a couple of years ago? I was Mac was probably his favorite of all a few years earlier than me, but I guess I became number two because he came to me one day and said, you seem like you got some talent. I said, well, I hope so, Dr. Bolden. He said, I want you to think about running for president of the Clark College Men's Association. I said, but I'm just a freshman. He said, well, next year you can do it. Sure enough, I ran for president of the Clark College Men's Association, and I got elected. That was my first experience getting elected to an office. And that carried on, that kind of training right here on campus helped instill in me the value of leadership at a very, very early age.
I want to be respectful of time because I know you got a book signing coming up. I got two questions, and I'm gonna tell you the last question I'm gonna ask is about your legacy. But prior to that, after reading the book, yes, you're president of the city council, and yes, you're the highest ranking African American for Coca-Cola, and yes, you've had a long storied career. Arguably, to me, your magnum opus was the Africa Group. And the reason why I say this, Trustee Ware, Emeritus, is because the Berlin Conference in 1881 divided Africa up like it was a loaf of bread, yes, without any regard to land, without any regard to culture or tribal divisions. And you were the individual with your needle and thread, sewed it all together. We believe in Africa. Can you just talk about that ever so briefly?
Well, my belief was that, first of all, I was a businessman. I was there to sell Coca-Cola.
Mm-hmm.
But what I realize that in order to get the maximum benefit out of our investments, that we needed to have Africans engaged at every level of the value change process, not just as consumers, but as distributors, as owners and operators of bottling franchises. And that's why we created, on the other hand, that kind of entrepreneurial and business strategy on the ground. But we created the Coca-Cola Africa Foundation. You cannot be successful. And we proved that time and time again in Africa unless you are constantly focusing on issues like health, issues like education, issues like transportation, communications, training schools, et cetera. And so we started to invest in people in every region of Africa that we had an operation. We had also a Coca-Cola Foundation or giving function so that our corporate social responsibility reflected what Robert W. Woodruff said, who was the patriarch of the Coca-Cola Company. Woodruff said that we want to be a welcome citizen, a welcome and participating citizen in every community, every nation, every city, every town, every hamlet that we do business. I took him for his word. And we started to invest in Africa. We started to invest in the people and develop, you know, the one of the guys that I recruited to back to Africa was Alex Cummings. Alex Cummings is a graduate of Clark Atlanta University, MBA school here. Well, Alex was working for Pillsbury International as the head of finance of that group. I recruited Alex from Pillsbury, brought him back. He was one of those talented people. When I said we believe in Africa, we're going to find those people to bring them back to Africa. Well, Alex was a Liberian born.
Got his MBA from the B school.
B school here. I brought him in, and I put him through the test of everything. I said, Alex, your first assignment is going to be deputy division president based out of Lagos, Nigeria. He said, what? That's very close. I thought he was going to say, what? I don't want to go. He said, that's very close to Liberia, my home, so I can go back home and visit my folk. And so it was that kind of thing. Another gentleman, French chap named Bill Egby. Bill, I recruited from a big firm out of France, and I can't remember the name, but Bill became the, Bill spoke obviously French, but he became the division president of the Francophone countries. And eventually, Bill became the president of Coca-Cola Southern Africa, which was our biggest operating unit. And so we dispelled the myth in Africa. You know, the myth, the biggest myth in human resources perspective in Africa is that you couldn't hire a Nigerian to supervise a Kenyan. You couldn't hire a Zimbabwean to supervise a Moroccan. We dispelled all of those myths. We found the best and most talented people, and when we couldn't find them, we went into the universities around the world and brought them in as interns. That to me is holistic marketing.
And while you were doing that in Africa, you were adding color to the boards of not only Coca-Cola, but other boards. I tell my students all the time, if you went to any quarterly board meeting in New York or Chicago or whatever, and you saw nothing but black faces, you would question it immediately. What's going on? What are you folks doing? But we go to any board meeting of the Fortune 500 and see nothing but white male faces, and no one questions it at all.
Yeah.
White males are only 30% of the population. No one questions it But you changed that dynamic.
Well, when I said a few minutes ago that my life was just beginning when I started writing that second iteration of my book, it was just beginning because I took a different kind of approach to corporate America. I started my journey in corporate governance. I moved from day-to-day operation, running essentially businesses, organizations worldwide for the company, to corporate governance, sitting on the boards of directors of Chevron Corporation, and chairing the Executive Compensation Committee of the third largest oil company in the world. And you talking about learning and having to learn something quick. Man, I had to go back to Stanford University and learn. By the way, there's another thing I want to say about education. It's continuous, it's ongoing, it's forever.
Lifelong.
Every inflection point in my career, I went back to school to bone up on something. When I was promoted vice president of special markets, I went to Georgia State at night to work on my executive MBA at Georgia State. I was in the first executive MBA program at Georgia State. I was one of those people. The president of Georgia Power, a guy by the name of Bill Dahlberg, was in my class. So I went back, and then when I was promoted to another position at Coke, president of Coca-Cola Africa.
You went to Harvard.
I went to Harvard to study in the International Senior Management Program, where I got a degree in International Senior Management. I knew my weaknesses, and I wanted to be the best that I could be. I wanted to be able to perform at the very highest level. And so continuous education. And so when I went to chair the Executive Compensation Committee, I said, I want to know everything there is about executive compensation. So I went to Stanford on my trips out to San Ramon to a board meeting. I would carve out a couple of days before the board meeting, go to Stanford, who had one of the most renowned corporate compensation operations or schools, and I would take those courses. And man, when I came into the boardroom, I was ready. I could speak the language of compensation, which is a, as you know, it is a strange language.
Oh, without a doubt.
And very, very financially based and very accounting, very principled kinds of things. So, yeah, and then at Cummins Engine, I tell this final story about when I went there. I said, why won't you guys, I was elected to the board of Cummins, I can't remember the exact year, but at any rate, they were doing business in China left and right, in Mexico, all over Latin America, all over Europe. Why aren't you in Africa? And what's going on over there? Well, the reason why they weren't is that they simply had this stigma about doing business in Africa. I said, come on, let me tell you what I want to do. I want you, the president, chief operating officer of Cummins, let's crank up the corporate jet, we're going to Africa. And I want to show you something. I'm going to show you some opportunities. And I did. I took him to Nigeria. He fell in love with Nigeria as a point of distribution for diesel engines and component parts for Cummins. And I took him to Angola, and we went into Dos Santos, the prime minister of Angola's office, and Tom Leinberger, who is now the CEO of Cummins, he was amazed that DeSantis just stopped and looked at me and said, "What are you doing here, Carl? Is you with these guys?" I said, "Yeah, I thought you were Coca-Cola." But that's, I knew heads of state that way in Africa. And so the Wall Street Journal did an article, 2011, I think it was, that cited the board members who were contributing, board members who were contributing to the bottom line in a positive way of the boards that they served on. And they selected two corporate directors from around the country, and you can pull this up on on your, and I was one of them who contributed because of what I did, taking the CEO. They invested lots of money in Africa, set up an office in Johannesburg, regional office. They had, the business is booming.
Well, that's going to segue into this final question, because I know you want to get out there and add pen to paper with your books. All right, so what do you want your legacy to be?
Wow. Well, you know, I think my legacy is that of someone who did the right thing, loved people, worked hard, gave back to his community, and served well. Just that simple.
Well, you've done more than served well. It's just an honor for me to be on this stage with you, because I have seen history firsthand here in Atlanta. And just to know that every Tuesday and Thursday, I get an opportunity to walk the same bricks of WB Du Bois, Dr. Brawley, okay? I mean, the Henderson Student Center. I mean, these were all game changers. And certainly last, but certainly not least, Carl and Mary Ware Building. You can't ask for more than that, and
thank
I want
so
to
much.
Shake your hand, bro.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Doctor.
Mm-hmm. Well, are we going to, what's the next? Okay, do you need this? All right. Emeritus Carl Ware has been so kind that he's going to take a few questions from those here in the audience. If you have something on your mind that you would certainly like to add.
Good. First of all, I would like to thank you so much for coming on behalf of our Clark Atlanta family, the 33rd SGA administration, the freshman class council, and the freshman student body. Before we start on questions, we have a gift for you and Mrs. Ware. Can Mrs. Ware please stand? This gift is presented on behalf of Dr. George T. French Jr., Dr. Lori Sandler, our VP of Alumni Relations, and our freshman student body, being presented by our freshman class president, Jaden Williams, our freshman class secretary, Sierra Williams.
Thank you so very much. Thank you so, so very much.
You're welcome.
I'll wear it with honor and distinction.
Thank you.
We will wear them. Thank you.
From the audience. How do you think your time at Clark College prepared you for the world?
Well, when I think about my time here at Clark College, I think about one word and one feeling: confidence.
Yeah, that's it.
Confidence. I never went into a situation where I doubted whether or not I could do something or get something done or accomplished. And that's what I learned and was instilled in me here at Clark College. Dr. Brawley, Dr.
Stella Burrow Brooks, my English teacher, my drama teacher, Dr. Esther Jackson, my math teachers, my education advisor, Dr. Escaping your name right now, Pearly Dove, Dr. Pearly Dove. Folk like that who just would not allow you to walk around campus with your head hung down. Mm-hmm. Hold your head up, son. What's wrong with you today? Mm-hmm. Get on with it, you know. Couldn't be that bad, but just instilling the confidence in me that I could do, that I could achieve. Keeping that shyness at bay. I tell you, one of the things that Clark allowed me to do was to start a rock and roll group, an R&B group here on campus, and we were called the Grand Prix. And so, you remember the old car, what is it, Pontiac Grand Prix? Grand Prix. Well, we would perform at talent shows on the stage here over at Harkness, one of the other buildings, Davidge Auditorium. And I got up the confidence to do the James Brown slide on. confidence, yeah, okay, thanks. I'll try not to be so long in my answers so everybody can answer the question.
How you doing, Dr. Ware? I just had a quick question. Serving as Miss Freshman, I am also a member of NAACP. And so my question to you is, what would you give for advice for other people that want to be a part of, you know, social justice things? And what tools would you give them, you know, in being a part of something, just like you being a game changer for being a history maker, that they can also be history models in the making, as we are in an era of history changing things as well?
You're a member of the NAACP?
Yes, sir.
Are you a leader here on campus?
I serve as a social media chair on the e-board.
Oh, how wonderful is that? That is as good training and contribution that you could ever make. So many of our historical civil rights organizations are suffering for lack of leadership, and one of the reasons is that not enough young people like you are volunteering and getting involved in perpetuating the goals and objectives and the visions for those organizations. So I applaud you for doing what you're doing. And my advice to you is to just spread the news, spread the gospel, get more people involved in what you're doing. That's really ultimately where leadership starts. It starts right here where you are. What's your major, by the way?
Music.
Music?
Yes, sir.
Oh, wow. Oh, well, I tell you, that's going to be, are you majoring in writing as an agent or creating, or what aspect of it? Of music.
Performance, but my concentration is commercial composition, where I also learn music production and songwriting.
Wonderful. Good luck and congratulations on doing what you're doing. Thank you.
Okay. Hey, y'all. Can y'all hear me?
We hear you. You can pull your mask down if you don't mind, so I can hear you a little bit clearer.
Okay.
I couldn't quite get everything that the previous person.
Alrighty, so my question for today is, what piece of information from this book do you use to inspire you to keep pushing forward?
Wow, that I use to, that, or that you can use?
Yes.
That you can use. I think the passage in the book that I think resonates most is, no matter where you come from, no matter your birth, you too can achieve, you can succeed, and you can overcome, and you can make a difference in your time on this earth. If you get that message, that is core leadership quality right there. strength.
Thank you so much.
Sure.
Hi. So you've contributed a lot to our community. My question to you is, what contribution are you most proud of?
Wow, that's a very, very good question. And I have never really thought about that that way, because, you know, contributions have different layers and different styles. You can contribute money, you can contribute time, you can contribute energy. I think probably I would say writing this book was my greatest contribution ever. Notwithstanding all the money that Mary and I have given and all of the other things that I have done, to be able to capture my life and give it back to you the way it is spelled out in that book is my greatest accomplishment ever. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Eternity Mitchell. I'm from a little small town called Hickory, North Carolina. I wanted to ask you, you know, my grandfather, he was also a sharecropper, and he's now a businessman. He owns the oldest black funeral home in my hometown. Wow. And it's a blessing, you know, being able to grow up in that lineage, although, you know, he has certain stories where he said, like, he wanted to do that since he was about 9 years old when he saw, you know, that's what he wanted to do. So I really just wanted to know, what was that turning point where you knew that sharecropping was not what you were going to do for the rest of your life? You know, yeah, like that.
That turning point was every day.
Absolutely.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Really, what was that turning point? I guess, you know, really, when we stopped sharecropping, which would have been about my, 1957 thereabouts, I was high school, early 13 years old, thereabouts. It was at that point where my parents had demonstrated that there was something bigger, larger, and that we could do with ourselves. And the fact that they emphasize that all of y'all got to go to school and you got to get your education, and becoming the first generation college student in my family was the turning point of my life. That was it. And the rest... Wow. It's history.
I appreciate you. And I also just want to say thank you for being an inspiration to all of us.
Thank you.
There are many of us who are first generation. I am a first generation Coca-Cola scholar. So I'm thankful to have that encouragement. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. And all the best to your grandfather. Tell him I said, keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Thank
so
you.
Much.
Okay.
Can't hear you.
Oh, man.
Sorry.
Sorry about that. Good evening. My name is Ahmad Menace. I'm from St. Louis, Missouri. And I guess the one question I would have is, you know, being when you were young and you were at Clark College, then Clark College, what advice would you give to young black men who want to get involved in business and just want to do that with their lives? Like, what would you tell them to start and start looking?
Well, first of all, find something that you're passionate about. Something that you really, truly enjoy doing, creating, just being a part of, and then figure out your niche in life. Connect that passion to what your skill set, what you're training to do, and how you want to execute the rest of your life against that strategy. Listen, one of the things that I never, ever did, I never put making money or earning money first. I always put whether or not it would make me happy. Was I making a contribution? Is this a service to someone else? And somehow or another, the Lord took control over the rest of it. I didn't become wealthy because I sat out to become wealthy, okay? But it was, in a sense, a byproduct of what I wanted to do truly with my life. And that goes back to what I said about Dr. King's inspiration to me. Little did he know that when he stood on that balcony and he was assassinated, and just before that, he had said what his new vision for civil rights would be, and that was moving from protests to politics and economics. Well, that inspired me to do what I did, to take the power of the ballot box, to take public policy and transform that into economic benefits and realities for African Americans.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Kendrick Berry. I'm from Newark, New Jersey. And I have a question. So Dr. Kimbrough asked you about what did you want your legacy to be? So when he asked that, I believe that he was asking, like, most men, you're supposed to have integrity. But was there any time that you felt like you had to manipulate your way through because other people hated on you, or you tried to push your way through it, but you couldn't, so you manipulated it? When is that a good time to do it and it's not considered bad?
Well, great question. Very powerful question. There have been so many times when I've found myself in that conundrum, if you will, of whether I responded to racism one way or the other, whether I confronted head on, or whether I just got smarter, and dealt with it in a more effective way. I'm gonna tell you, there have been a couple of times, even at Coca-Cola, I remember I had a racist manager who I reported to. I won't call his name, but he was from Australia. You read my book, you can pick that up. He made me so angry one day. I did something that I still think about now, and I almost regret having done it, but I did it. He picked on me. He tried to nitpick and tried to put obstacles in my progress at Coca-Cola Company. After my guru and my mentor died, Roberta Gazueta, the guys were coming after me left and right because they just saw this brother who probably was going to be their boss. And there were five or six of us competing in that arena for the top positions. I wasn't competing, I was just doing my job. But I said to our boss, I said, if you don't get this guy off my back, and I meant every word of it, I'm gonna throw him out of the 24th floor of the Coca-Cola Company. I don't know what got over me other than the fact that I just saw the Ku Klux Klan. I mean, I went back and I reflected and I said, now that's not the way you're supposed to react to that. Mm-hmm. The way I'm supposed to react to that is to get smarter, get better, and just go on and do what I know is in the best interest of the share owners of the Coca-Cola Company, my fellow Coca-Cola employees, and my family. That's the way I want to do it, and be prepared. On paper, I was probably the most educated person in the Coca-Cola Company, on paper. And we delivered against that preparation and every job that we did. But still, there were those who, as you said, hated on me and did things to put up obstacles in my way. But we figured out a way to be smarter, to deal with it in a better way. Like my father said, how do you manage adversity, fear, hatred, and bigotry? You have to dig deep
And sometimes you just have to say, well, there's a way to manage around this guy or this person, and there's a way to get on top of it. Being better prepared than he or she. And again, the power for black men in particular, and I don't mean no disparaging comment about black women, because black women have the same burdens and even to some extent greater than we as men, but we in particular have to be stronger than we ever been in the history of this country right now to overcome and to get on top of and stay ahead of the game. Just be prepared. Know yourself. Have confidence in yourself. You'll make it. You'll do it. I know you will. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Well, Carl Ware, Trustee Emeritus, thank you very much for taking time out of your busy schedule. I want to keep everybody on task. Like I said, I want you to go out there and autograph some books. I assume that is the last question. To recap some of the tidbits that you have shared with us: confidence, know your passion, never be so poor that you don't have something that you can share with somebody else, lifelong learning, and what you learned from Maynard Jackson, Bishop Tutu, Nelson Mandela, Roberto Goizueta. Am I missing anybody else out of your big five? What is the measure of a well-lived life, students? Is it how big? Is it how vast? Is it how affluent? Is it how wealthy? Is it how rich? No. For the last hour or so, the well-lived life is measured by how many lives you have touched along the way. And Carl Ware, you have touched, I dare to say, hundreds of thousands, if not millions, and we salute you. Thank you very much. Before you take your next segment, Mr. Ware,
and Kefabian, you can play that song while I'm talking.
That face that is usually covered by her phone has finally...
We must begin to tell our young.
There's a world waiting for you.
Yours is the quest that... it's just